Good morning and happy Mother's Day. Thank you for being here. I thank God so much for the privilege of being born in a godly home with a godly mother. I want to talk this morning about 10 characteristics of a godly mother that came from God. I believe when God created Adam's body from the dust of the ground, He put His spirit on the inside, and everything that God is, that divine nature, was planted in Adam. But very early, God said, it's not good for the man to be alone. I'm going to make a helpmate, a partner for him. And so God caused a sleep to come on Adam, and He took not only part of Adam's body to create woman, I believe He took some of the godly character nature that was in Adam, took some of those characteristics and placed them in the woman. And I believe that's why it's God's plan for a man and wife to join together as a team, as a partner, because each one has part of God's divine character, natural characteristics that they provide and bring to raise that family. I look back at our memorial board this morning, and there have been at least 21 godly mothers that have passed on in the 21 years since I've been here. These were women that I loved, respected, I honored them, and I thank God for them. They were women who said they prayed for me and they prayed for this church every day. It's a godly heritage that we have. And so I want to play a video to honor some of these great matriarchs and women of faith that have been an important part of our lives. I grew up on a farm. I remember playing outside as a young boy with neighbor kids, playing baseball or some other sport. And I'd hear my mom call, "Jim, supper time." And I thank God for those wonderful memories. My mom said, "Jim, you have wonderful memories to look back at. We have a glorious future ahead of us. And today, God will give you the faith that you need." And a big part of who I am today came from my mom, from her faith and faithfulness that was instilled in my heart. And I'm looking forward to that supper time in heaven. You know, the Bible talks about the marriage of the Lamb and the marriage supper of the Lamb. I don't know what these ladies are doing. If there's a kitchen in heaven, they're helping prepare the meal. And I'm looking forward to that day when Jesus appears and says, "Come on home, it's supper time." Here's a song sung by one of my favorite singers, "Supper Time."
Of childhood, I used to play till evening shadows come. Then winding down an old familiar pathway, I heard my set off, son. Come home, come home, it's supper time. The shadows lengthen fast. Come home, it's supper time. We're going home at last.
Some of the fondest memories of my childhood were woven around supper time. When Mom would come to the back steps of the old home place, she'd say, George, come on in at supper time. Oh, oh my, but I'd love to hear that once more. But you know, for me, time has woven the realization of a truth that is even more thrilling. And that's when the Lord comes to the portals of glory and says to come on in for supper time. And we'll be gathered around the table with the Lord himself at the greatest supper time of them all. In visions now, I see her standing yonder, and her familiar voice I hear once more. The banquet table's ready up in heaven. Upon the golden shore, come home, come home, it's supper time. The shadows deepen fast. Come home, come home, it's supper time. We're
amazing song by George Johns. I have such wonderful memories sitting around the table with my mother and father, brothers and sisters. And like George said, I look forward to that supper time in heaven when the family of God gathers around and we rejoice together at the marriage supper of the Lamb. I put a video on this week in honor of my mom, who I love and miss so very much. And the title was just simply this: She Loved. My mom loved people. I remember she said, I don't have a ministry. Jim, you're a teacher, a pastor. Dad's a teacher, and I don't really have a ministry. I said, Mom, Paul lists in Corinthians a list of different ministries in the church, and one of them is hospitality. My mom had the ability to make people feel welcome. My mom took young couples into her home that didn't have mother or father in the area, and she made them feel like family. You couldn't be in my mom's home for more than a few minutes and feel like you were family. She loved people. She loved kids. She taught Sunday school for 28 years. She loved each one of her kids. She loved her grandkids, her great-grandkids. I think Keegan was the last one she held in her hands before she was promoted to glory in 2005. But I know this about my mom. She loved people. I want to talk to you this morning about 10 godly things that our mothers do for us. And I believe these characteristics came from God. They're not only godly characteristics, they came from Him. He planted these in Eve. And these are things that make our mothers representatives of God here on the earth. Number one, your mother chose to give you birth. You are here today because your mother chose to give you birth. I have a video on our FCBC website about the Heath brothers. The older brother sings lead. He has twin brothers that sing harmonies. And I put a song on there this week as they talk about when their mom was carrying these twins. that the doctors told her there's a real serious problem. One of the twins is way underdeveloped. We don't think he'll survive, and we recommend that you terminate his pregnancy. And their mom was a Christian lady, and she says, absolutely not. Whatever God gives me, it's God's will for me to have. And she said, I will raise that child and love him if God gives him to me. He was indeed born small, but he caught up. He looks identical to his brother today. And they're singing for the glory of God, I Choose Life. Go to our website, Finchford Community Bible Church, and listen to that video. I'm so very grateful. My mother chose to give me life. I was surprised to find that there's a name of God that says that. In Psalms 95, it's called El Chul, the God who gave you birth. It's God who places his spirit on the inside of us. Yes, your body was born from your mother's body, and John 3 says that. Your flesh was born from the flesh. Your earthly body came from, was birthed in your mother's body. But the spirit is born of the spirit. I believe that God places a spirit in every child at conception. And even though the mother and father give the characteristics to that child's body, it's God who places a spirit, an eternal spirit, on the inside of that child. El Chul, the God who gave you birth. Just like he formed Adam's body out of the dust of the ground, he breathed his spirit into Adam. You know, your mother chose to give you birth, and she loved you even before you were born. While she was carrying you, I've seen mothers, Pat, there's little child, sing to their child, invite you to come listen to their child. They feel that child on the inside before he's born, and they come to love that child before it's born. And our Heavenly Father does the same thing. Jesus said, you didn't choose me, I chose you. You are a child of God today because he chose you. He loved you even before you were born into the family of God. I believe God was watching over you, guiding your footsteps, preparing all of the things that happened in your life to bring you to that point to become a child of God and to receive and honor him as Lord. John 3:16 says, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. God gave his son a long time before we were even born. God loved us before we were born, and he chose to give us birth. Number two, your mother protected you even before you were born physically. While you were developing and being formed inside of her, she was protecting you. She was careful what she ate. She was careful the activities she was involved in, what kind of things she took into her body, because she wanted to make sure you were born healthy and strong and safe. The name of God that coincides with that is Jehovah Nissi. It means God, my banner. There are several kinds of banners. A marching band has a banner when they go down the street in the parade. The army carries a flag before it. I love the pictures of the flag bearers in the Revolutionary War and in the Civil War. These men felt it an honor to carry that flag as a banner of what they stood for. I love to see on the football field when the armed forces carry out the flags. It's a banner that goes before them to define who they are, what they stand for. And that is our Lord. He is our banner. He goes before us. God told Moses, I am your banner. I will go before you. You know, just like your mother protected you while you were being born, birthed on the inside of her, God covered you before you were born. Psalms 139 says that even while I was in the dark places, before I was even fully formed or developed, you were covering me, you were protecting me. Jehovah Nissi, he's the God who surrounds and covers us. It says he covered us like a screen a protection, a hedge around us. God, my banner, who protects me. That was our mothers. Number three, your mother nourished you before you were born. The nourishment that was provided to you as you were developing came from your mother. Food and oxygen from her body and her blood went through the umbilical cord into your body. So every bit of nourishment and cleansing that you had came from her and from her blood. God has a name that corresponds called El Shaddai. Literally means the big-breasted one. The great nourisher. The one who supplies food and nourishment to our bodies. In the New Testament, Paul uses this phrase. It is God who provides us with the sincere milk of the word so that we may grow. The cleansing in our bodies comes from the blood of our Lord. And the food and nourishment that we need comes from Him. It's the Word that feeds us and helps us to grow and mature and develop. He nourished us. Even before we were born, our mothers were supplying what we needed. Even before you were born into the family of God, God was teaching you, directing you, trying to develop you and prepare you to become His child in this Word. Number four, we found comfort in the arms of our mother, and in her presence we found rest. You know, the first thing that happens when a child is born is that they place that baby in the mother's arms, and that mother holds that baby, cradles that baby, and that happens almost daily, many times a day as that child's growing up, held by the mother. There's something about being held by the mother that brings peace. The name of God that corresponds to that is Jehovah Shalom, the God of peace. He brings peace and comfort in His presence. We sing that song, in His presence, there is peace. There's something about being in a mother's arms that brings comfort to that child. God provides a rest for His children. Hebrews said, there remaineth a rest for the children of God. And we find that in God's presence and doing His will. You know, I remember several years ago when I was struggling with depression, discouragement over finances, and I was so discouraged emotionally and mentally, and I could find no peace within myself, and many nights I would say, Lynn, can we go out to Mom and Dad's? And she said, we were there last night. I said, I know, but there's just something about being there. Just going and sitting in the living room with my mom and dad there, being in that presence brought peace to my heart. And a little child, you've seen images or pictures of a little child that gets scared and runs and holds on to his mom's leg or hides behind his mom's apron. There's something about being with mom that provides that sense of security and protection. Jesus used that example like a mother hen. He said to Jerusalem, I desire to draw you close so that you could gather under the safety of my wings. There's something about being in God's presence that brings peace, and only the presence of God brings peace. I mentioned Hebrews. God provides a rest to His children. There is a place of rest. But along with that verse, it says labor to enter into my rest. I find those two words contradictory. Labor, rest. Work, rest. And I struggled to understand what that meant for a long time, but I see now that, for example, the children of Israel were in Egypt, slaves in Egypt. God promised them a land with milk and honey. I'll bring you out, and I'll provide for all of your needs abundantly. So God brought them out of Egypt after some terrible plagues and events in their lives, brought them to the Red Sea, and He delivered them from destruction. Then they spent 40 years wandering in the wilderness, lacking so many essentials in life, but God provided for their needs, and He brought through a generation that was prepared to go into the promised land. And they came to the River Jordan, and God provided a miracle and brought them through, and we've all seen God's miracles in our lives. And then they came to the cities that God had ordained they should possess, but the land was filled with giants, and they had to fight against the giants to get what God had promised them. They had to struggle and labor all of their life and then fight for what God wanted them to have. But once they arrived there, then they could settle in and find rest and peace in the land. And I believe it's God's plan for our lives that we search and find that place where God wants us to be. And when you're in the place God wants you to be, doing the thing God wants you to do, it brings rest and peace in your soul. And labor to find that place of rest. Paul said, I've learned to be content. I've learned to be content. It's something that we learn. Doesn't happen naturally. Human nature always wants more. But God wants us to be content with what we have. Number five, our mothers give us comfort. We fall down, get hurt, skin a knee, cut a finger, bring it to mom, and she'll say, oh, let mom kiss it. I'll make it better. When somebody's afraid, thunder in the night or some other event, they run to mom. There's something about being in mom that's comforting, that calms and soothes the anxieties, the pains, the hurts. The name of God that corresponds is Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals. He not only saves us from sin, God's plan is to restore us spiritually, but he also wants our bodies to be healthy. Beloved, I wish above all things that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. By his stripes, we are healed. God's plan covers the healing of our bodies. And ultimately, we're going to get brand new glorified bodies as well. I am the God who heals, Jehovah Rapha. I am the God of all comfort. He's the God that brings comfort to us in our time of need. And he said, I want you to use that comfort that I gave to you to comfort other people. Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals. God's plan is for us to be healthy and strong and at peace, spirit, soul, and body. He's the God of all comfort. He comforts us in our time of need. Number six, your mother cared for you. Our mothers were there to wash our hands, to wash our feet, to wash our clothes, to provide us with clothes. They helped dress us. They helped pack a lunch for us for school. They made sure we had our gym shoes along or gym shorts or whatever we needed. They'd ask, have you got this? Have you got that? It's a mom who cares for you no matter what the circumstance. She wants to help you be prepared for what's ahead. And our God cares for his children. In fact, we're admonished, cast all of your cares on him because he cares for you. You know, I think we use the phrase love too ambiguously. We can love pizza, we can love the dog, you can love the Cubs, you can love the Hawkeyes. But I believe a greater phrase would be this. By this will all men know that you're my disciples because you care for one another. This church cares about people. When we have a prayer request, other people remember it. They pray for it because we care about what's happening in one another's lives. When somebody has a need, we pray together. When somebody has a testimony of God's goodness, we rejoice together. See, we have a God whose name is Jehovah Jireh, which means the God who will provide. God will supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. God provides us with all that we need for spiritual growth and godliness, and he'll take care of our earthly needs as well. You know, I think the root cause of so many struggles and dissatisfaction in people's life, and the root cause, I believe, of all sin is I want this, I want that, I want. But the Lord is my shepherd. I will not want. He will supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. You know, I one time had people make a list of five things that they want in their life. And then I said, turn the paper over and list 20 things that you're thankful that you have. And then when they finished, I said, all right, now look at your paper. And at that point, you had to make a choice. Either look at the things that you want, or look at the things that you have. You can't look at both sides at the same time. You have to focus on one. And if you focus on the things that you want, it'll end up to frustration and anxiety, dissatisfaction. But if you can focus on the things that you have, you can find contentment, you find peace, and you find joy in the Lord. It depends where you're looking. The Lord will supply all of our needs according to his riches, according to his riches in glory. He loves you, he cares for you, and he wants to provide for you. Our mothers demonstrated that, the incredible love and care that they had. And even when that child grows up and leaves home, the mother is continually caring about what's happening in that child's life. Number 7, mothers teach us to walk. They teach us to talk. They teach us to take care of ourselves. Their goal is for us to mature and take care of ourselves. But until then, they're there teaching us, helping us in all these little things that we need to do. The name of God that corresponds is Jehovah Ra. The Lord is my shepherd. See, a shepherd cares for the sheep, guides and protects the sheep, leads them into other pastures. The outstanding characteristic about a shepherd is that he loves the sheep. Loves the sheep. If he loves being a shepherd, if he loves the money, the prestige, the title, Jesus said when tough times come, he'll run away. But the good shepherd is there to take care of him no matter what the situation. Danger, needs, the shepherd is there to provide for them. And that's our mothers. They're there to teach us and to guide us, so that we can learn to grow and mature in the Lord. David talked about that in Psalms, and he said, it is God who will teach us and instruct us in the way that we should go. The Bible talks about ever growing in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior. Jesus said, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you and teach you all things. And bring things back to your remembrance of what you said. I remember so many things from my mom and her wisdom and her teaching and her guidance in my life. And that's God's plan, his desire to guide us and teach us. But along with that, at the same time, my mom gave me correction. I remember times when she'd just point her finger at me, or my mom's favorite tool for spanking was a 3-foot yardstick. And she used that many times. Not because she wanted to hurt, destroy me. She disciplined because she wanted me to do good and to make right choices. For example, I remember sitting in the front row of the church, and I finally talked my parents into letting me sit there with my friends in the front row. But she said, Jim, you need to behave. And if not, I'll click my fingers. And if you hear fingers clicking, you better pay attention. And I remember sitting in that row, and if we hear somebody click their fingers, we'd turn around to see whose mom it was. And if she was pointing at me, I knew it's time to straighten up and behave. I remember at least one time when I didn't. I heard the clicking, I saw the finger, but I went on with my behavior. And my mom came down to the front row. She walked right down that aisle, took me by the ear and twisted that till it hurt. And she directed me right back to sit between her and Dad. My mom gave correction because she loved me. And one of the names of God and Jesus is Adonai, which means Lord, Master, the one who directs us and tells us what to do. He's Lord of our lives, and we make choices based on what he wants us to do. The Bible says God will chasten his children. Whom he loves, he chastens. I remember making rules for my kids. We lived on Rainbow Drive when my girls were small. And if our front yard and drive sloped down to Rainbow Drive, it was a very busy street those years. They were rebuilding University Avenue, a lot of traffic, zip, zip. And so I made a rule for my girls that if they're playing with a ball and it rolls down the drive, if you don't catch it before it gets to the sidewalk, let it go. Do not go beyond the sidewalk. Now, I didn't make that rule to be mean, to be the boss, to be belligerent. I made that rule because I cared about my girls and I felt like I knew more about the dangers of cars than they did. And I made that rule for their benefit, to keep them from danger. Whom the Lord loves, he chastens. I remember some of my mom's admonitions. Jim, you're the oldest. You should know better. Jim, you should set the example for other people. I remember my mom telling me, Jim, never ask other people to do what you should do for yourself. And my mom told me that even after I lost the fingers on this hand. She didn't come home and baby me make over me and do every little thing for me. Jim, you need to learn to do this for yourself, whether it's to write with my left hand or all kinds of things. My mom didn't say that to be mean. She wanted me to grow and overcome this situation. And I don't think I wouldn't be the man I am today if it wasn't for my mother. I wouldn't be a member of the Waterloo Softball Hall of Fame. I wouldn't have learned to play the bass guitar. I wouldn't have learned to play golf. I don't think I'd be a pastor today. And I know I wouldn't have the attitude that says I can do all things through Jesus Christ. Even when I was in the hospital, the fifth day, the Lord sent somebody to tell me, Jim, you need to stop feeling sorry for yourself. You can do anything you want in this life. You work hard, trust in God. I got that can-do attitude in large part because of my mother's admonition. Never ask other people to do for you what you should do for yourself. The Lord loves us. Sometimes he chastens us by his voice. I remember my two girls have very different temperaments. And one time Christy was misbehaving in the car. I was driving the van, sitting in the driver's chair, and I told them to be quiet, stop fussing, stop bickering. And I turned around and I pointed my finger at Christy and I said, you're going to get spanking when we get home. And she started crying all right away. Just, I'm sorry. And she cried the rest of the way home. We got home. I said, Chris, you want your spanking now or you want to get ready for bed? I'll go get ready for bed. And so she went to her bedroom. I went down a little bit later and she's in bed still crying. And I said, Chris, Art said you were going to get a spanking, and you were misbehaving. I know. How do you spank a child that's already sorry and crying? So I said, I told you you're going to get spanking, so you get one. So I give her a little light tap, and I said, so there, learn your lesson. You know, and sometimes if we're tenderhearted, that's all God needs to do is correct us and say, Jim, you're wrong. You need to straighten up. God just wants to get our attention. You know, David said in Psalms, Lord, do not correct me in anger. David knew he'd done wrong. And he said, Lord, don't correct me in anger. I did that once. Christy was disobedient again, fussing in the car, and I told her to stop several times. Finally, I turned around, I got mad, disgusted, and I reached over with this hand of my stub and smack on the top of her legs as she sat right behind me, and it hurt. I hit her a lot harder than I intended, and she was wailing, she was hurting, and I felt bad. When we got home, I went to her bedroom and I said, "Chris, I struck you because you were being naughty. I know." I said, "You were wrong." But I said, "I was more wrong because I hit you in anger. And I want you to listen when I say things, but right now at this moment, I need to ask you to forgive me because I struck you in anger and I was wrong." David said that, "Lord, don't correct me in your anger." See, God's plan is for His Holy Spirit to speak to our hearts and for us to feel conviction. Just knowing that He's just pleased brings us to a desire to repent and to be in right standing and to have His favor. You know, I've got a verse on my card that says, "Speak the truth in love." Whether you're disciplining kids, grandkids, whether you're dealing with a friend, a co-worker, speak the truth in love, not in anger. Number 9, I'm so very thankful that my mom led me in the way to go by her words, by her actions, by her example. I saw the kind of godly person that we should all be. I learned that from her. And there's a name of our God that corresponds with that, said Jehovah Tsidkenu, a name you probably haven't heard, but it's in Jeremiah, and it means God, our righteousness. See, because David said in Psalms 139 that God will lead His children. See, we sing that song, God leads His dear children along, some through the water, some through the flood. Some through the fire, but all through the blood. The steps of the righteous are ordered of the Lord. Even Psalm 23 says, "The Lord's my shepherd, He leads me in paths of righteousness." See, God's plan is for us to follow after righteousness, and He'll lead us, and He came to earth to be our example. Our mom was that. My mom was a godly example of the kind of love and character and compassion that God wants us to have with one another. She led by her example, by her lifestyle. Tsidkenu. It's because of my mother's example that I'm the person that I am. She loved people. She loved her kids. She loved her grandkids. She loved the Sunday school children that she taught. She loved young couples that she brought for Thanksgiving or Easter. She loved people. And that's the most important characteristic of a shepherd. He loves the sheep. He cares about the sheep and wants to see good things happen in their lives. Jehovah Tsidkenu. God leads us in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. It's for our good, but He leads us in paths of righteousness so that we can be a testimony to others of His goodness. Last one, my mother prayed for her kids every day. God spoke to her early on as she was raising 6 children. "Mary, you pray for your kids every day and I'll take care of them." Well, later that became 15 grandkids, their spouses, and now it's up to great-grandchildren. Moms pray for their families, for their kids. There's a name of God that corresponds with that also, one I hadn't heard before either, but it's called Megas Herus. Mega means the big, Herus is the priest, and that's our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the high priest. In fact, Hebrews said he is the high priest of our confession. When we pray, he receives and hears our prayers. And Jesus told the disciples, whatever you ask the Father in my name, I'll take your prayers, I'll take your requests, and I'll present them to the Father. He is the high priest of our confession, even our salvation confession. Jesus said, if you confess me before men as Lord in your life, I'll confess you to the Father. In fact, Jesus is even praying for you. Peter was being attacked by the enemy, and Jesus told him, Peter, Satan has desired to shake you like wheat and to rattle your cage and to just cause serious repercussions in your life. But Jesus said, Peter, I have prayed for you. I have prayed for you that your faith will not fail. If Jesus did that for Peter, I believe he's doing that for us. He's praying for you and I that our faith will not fail. He's there to hear our prayers, and he's there to pray about things that we don't even know about. Peter didn't realize Satan was out to destroy him and was after him in this way, but Jesus knew it. He saw it ahead of time, and he said, I've been praying for you, Peter, ahead of time. And that's our Lord. Megas Herus, our chief priest, our high priest. In fact, Hebrews 7 says he ever lives. He lives forever to intercede for you. He's there asking the Father on your behalf to guide, to direct, and take care of you. God has incredible plans for your life. He loves you very much. I believe that all 10 of these characteristics that I talked about today came from God. They're a part of God's names of who he is, and he placed those characteristics in our mothers. I thank God for a godly mother. I look forward to seeing my mom at the supper table. You say, maybe my mom didn't have all of that. I don't know if any mother has all 10 of these qualities. None of us are perfect. But be thankful for what your mother did have. Be thankful for whatever godly influence she did have in your life. And if she didn't have all 10 of these, then you purpose and say, that's what I want in my life. Even if you didn't see all of this in your mom, then you choose to be a godly mother, grandmother, great-grandmother. You demonstrate these godly characteristics in your life and in your family. And I'm convinced if you do that, you'll have great success and influence in the lives of your kids, your grandkids. I'm so very thankful this Mother's Day for a godly mother. And I want to encourage you, if your mother's alive on the earth, call her today. Tell her you love her, you appreciate her, thank her for the things that she's done in your life. Remember, you have life in your body only because your mother chose to give you life. You are here physically because your mother chose to carry you, to nurture you for 9 months. To be born into this world. But by the same token, you only have life in your spirit because God chose to give it to you. You didn't choose him. He chose to give you life. If you have a godly mother, honor her today. No matter how many of these characteristics she had or didn't have, honor her. And then you purpose to be that kind of godly mother, grandmother, great-grandmother. Be that kind of godly woman that others can see Christ in you and give him the glory. Heavenly Father, I thank you this day for a godly mother. Thank you for Mary, who loved me, chose to give me life. Thank you that she protected me, nourished me, guided, and taught me to know and to honor and to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for her ministry of love to my physical needs, to my spiritual needs. Lord, I am here today because of her and her faithfulness. Lord, I look forward to seeing my mom. Lord, all these marvelous ladies that have been matriarchs of faith here in this church, I look forward to spending that supper time with them. God, I ask your blessing now on each one here today. May your good mercy follow us all the days of our lives till we live and dwell together in your home. This is our prayer. I believe that. I receive that in Jesus' name. All agree, will say with me, amen. Happy Mother's Day. God bless you all.
Hey guys, we're the three Heath brothers. When our mom was expecting my twin brothers, the doctors found a problem. Baby A was growing just fine, but baby B had stopped growing. My parents were heartbroken, so they went to a specialist, and the specialist said, option number one, you could terminate the pregnancy. My parents said, absolutely not. We believe that God is the giver of life, and we will take whatever he gives us. That day, our parents could have chosen to abort half the pregnancy. And as a result, our brother Christian wouldn't be here. This is why when we hear the subject of abortion, we take it personally. Please share this video if you believe that it is time for us as Americans to rise up and choose life.
So many lives are lost each day as millions of heartbeats are taken away. Our hearts are hurting, and God is hurting too. It's life or it's death. What will we choose? We choose life. We choose life. We will stand for the truth. We will stand for the right. They say we have a choice, because it's not a child, but we wanna hear that baby's cry. We choose life.
Some people may say that the choice is too hard. They say that we don't understand where they are.
God, help them to see their child through your eyes. In that desperate moment, please help them decide. To choose life, we choose life. We will stand for the truth. We will stand for the right. Choice, because it's not a child, but we wanna hear that baby's cry. We choose life. We've lost way too many, and God says it's time that we should arise and say, choose life. We will stand for the truth.